So I'll start with the context and the research question and motivation for this paper, and then I'll move to the model framework and describe that, and then go to the two different case studies that I ran, and then finish with the conclusion. So just to give a little bit of context, frequency regulation in Europe happens in three different control layers. There's primary, secondary, and tertiary, with different time intervals for how long they last and when they kick in. So primary starts very soon after a fault and lasts for about 5 minutes. Secondary control comes in about from 5 minutes to about 15 minutes, and then tertiary control is more manual and comes in slowly after that. So in Switzerland, there are separate markets for each of these control layers, for primary, secondary, and tertiary, plus or minus as well, and they are done in weekly tenders and are pay-assisted. So I worked in my thesis with the Zurich Cantonal Utility, AKZ, and they currently have a 1 megawatt battery that's fitting into their primary frequency control market. At the point of my thesis, we're in the process of looking at buying another battery, which was going to be greater than 5 megawatts, which was why they were working with my thesis to understand the profit possibilities. In addition to the battery storage, they had contracted different distributed load and generation units and combined them into a virtual power plant and used that to bid into the tertiary markets. So these included a run-of-river hydro plant, a PV plant, diesel gen sets, and flexible loads such as heat pumps and compressors. So this was the starting point for the thesis. And one of the things I did was look at the economic potential to looking at bidding into other markets. So on the graph on the left, there are the different average weekly bid prices for each of the markets over a year. We have primary in blue, secondary in red, and then the two tertiary markets in yellow and purple. And if you look at the red line, you can see that the secondary market has these spikes compared to the tertiary market. And in average, the prices for primary and secondary are much higher than the tertiary. And so this means that there's a potential to increase the overall revenue if we take the battery and the virtual power plant and bid into the primary and secondary markets instead of the primary and the tertiary market. So that leads to the research question, which is if we combine a battery storage system and this virtual power plant, is it economically and technically feasible to bid into the primary and secondary markets? Related questions are, what is the optimal bidding strategy for such a system, and what types of units are most valuable in the virtual power plant? But now on to the modeling framework. I developed an MPC, a model predictive controller, to simulate operation to determine both costs and technical feasibility. So I started with certain inputs, the control signal data, which is the historical control signal for the primary and secondary markets. Then as well, we had unit operation data from AKZ's virtual plant that already existed. And then you give it a configuration, which means the battery power and capacity, as well as the different capacities of all the different units. And finally, the reserve market data, which was shown in a previous slide. So the historical data gets fed into a forecast generator, which creates forecasts for what the signal might be to account for not having perfect information for the MPC. And as well, the unit data was used to develop unit models, which took into account operating constraints such as ramp rate limitations or minimum idle time and things like that. And all of those things were fed into the optimizer or the MPC, which determined on a 5-minute basis what the operation of the whole system should look like. Based on that five-minute output, the RTC, or real-time controller, determined the second-by-second operation of the plant. And that operation was used to determine the technical feasibility, and then when combined with the reserve market data, gave you the economic feasibility. So at a high level in the MPC, the goal was to minimize the use of the virtual power plant because that had costs associated with it, which is that term. And then additionally, to minimize the deviation of the state of charge of the battery. And that was due to manufacturer warranty requirements, that we had to keep the average state of charge over operation below 60%. And so that was this term. So in the real-time controller, there were a set of equations. At a high level, there's the system-level equation, which is the two different control signals combined into one. And then we had the offset provided by each of the different units, which is on a 5-minute period. And then the battery power was determined as the difference between the required control and then the offset provided by the rest of the units. So some important assumptions. I assumed that the revenue from each market was based on the average grid price and did not do any stochastic market clearing. I assumed that there was perfect forecasting of the availability of these hydro units and this combined heat power, etc. There, I ignored communication latencies in the MPC and simulated 4 representative weeks in the year and used that to determine the profit and feasibility. One note about the control signal forecasting, the primary and secondary signals were forecast separately for a couple of reasons. One was that the bidding strategy required us to scale the signal value depending on how much we would bid, what capacity we would be bid. So they had to be forecasted separately. And second, there was only 1 year of historical data available for the secondary market, which prevented the use of machine learning. There was not enough data to get a good result. And so for the primary signal, you see the results of the machine learning forecast here. The mean squared error was about 0.0029 for a whole year's worth of forecasts. For the secondary control, I ended up using statistical methods and linear regression and used an ARMA model, auto regressive moving average, to get forecasts looking ahead at different time horizons. So I started with 5 minutes, which is the blue line, and then up to 2 hours ahead, which is the red line. And then you can see that as we go forward in time, the prediction becomes less and less good, which puts a limit on the MPC horizon that I ended up using. In addition, I modeled the energy content of the signals, and this was to improve the robustness of the model. And so that is shown on the graph to the right. So moving to the first case study, this is looking at just the technical and economic feasibility of a certain VPP configuration. So we defined that, and then looked at various bidding strategies and energy capacities of the battery to see what would be the most optimal scenario for profit and technical feasibility. The battery energy was varied between 15, 20, and 25 megawatts, which is an energy to power ratio of 1.52 or 2.5 compared to the capacity. You can see the virtual power plant configuration here with the battery capacity at 10 megawatts. And then based on this, the model was used to run all these different scenarios, and the most profitable scenario was determined. So this is an example of 24 hours of simulation from the model. So you can see here the evolution of the battery state of charge. The dotted line here is the target SOC average over time. The blue line is the actual battery SOC as it is supported by the virtual power plant. And then you can see a baseline case where you just have the battery and no virtual power plant. And it shows that at some point you saturate the battery SOC, and so you cannot operate anymore. So this means that without the support of a virtual plant, you cannot actually use a battery to bid into both of these markets. And so you do need that support in order to be able to make this technically feasible. You can see here that the control signal and the battery output do not exactly match, and that difference is covered by the unit operation. And the more you utilize these units, the more cost they have, so then it's a trade-off between making it technically feasible and profitable. So this is a summary of the technical feasibility of all these different scenarios. So looking at the bidding strategy, there's 10 total megawatts for the battery capacity, and you can split that between the primary market and the secondary market, and I chose to do it in units of 1 megawatt increments. And as you can see, as you go to a higher secondary bid in the bottom row, it doesn't become technically feasible anymore, and that's because you run out of energy capacity in the battery, that you don't have enough virtual power plant capacity to support that. And this is because the secondary signal is longer, has a larger energy content, and is not as variable as a primary signal, which is more energy neutral. So if we look at the profit results here, we can see that for different energy to power ratios or different energy capacities, you have kind of a step change in profitability. So for the smaller battery in yellow, there's quite a bit less profit for a given bidding scenario, and that's because you need quite a bit more support from the virtual power plant to make it technically feasible, and that means extra cost, so then your profit is decreased naturally. It seems that there's not a significant difference between an energy ratio of 2 or 2.5, which I believe is partly due to the nature of the model, and it's not completely, it's a nonlinear model, so there's some discontinuities. In addition, it also shows that after a certain capacity, you don't get more benefit for the energy that you have in the battery. So you get higher revenues for increasing secondary bid because the secondary market has a higher price, but you also have a commensurate increase in the operating cost, and so at some point it becomes a trade-off. So that was using the model to determine what the optimal bidding strategy is for a given scenario, a given virtual power plant that you have and a given battery. The next question is, what is the best type of unit to include in my virtual power plant? And this was important for AKZ because they're continually adding units in their virtual power plant and going out and finding them. And so the way I simulated this was to create different virtual power plants with homogeneous units, so only one unit type. So one virtual power plant only had photovoltaic, one only had diesel gensets, etc. And I kept the capacity the same across all of them and used a slack variable, one to allow stability of the MPC and another to use as a metric of utility of how useful each unit type is. And so if you look at the results, there's the slack energy in the blue bars and the slack power in the red line. And what it shows is that for different units, there are different there's a different slack power and energy. And a lower slack energy means that there's a higher availability. So there's just the virtual power plant has more energy capacity overall to support the battery. A lower slack power means that there's a higher flexibility, means that the virtual power plant can change its output as needed in a more dynamic manner. And so we can see that the lowest in both of those is the combined heat and power plant. And that's because it is extremely flexible and also is always available. So that's kind of an expected result. So the conclusion, it's possible to use this MPC model to determine the optimal bidding strategy and required battery capacity to make such an operation technically and economically feasible. The secondary market share in your bid is hugely important for both revenue and for cost. And lastly, the unit types that offer high flexibility and availability are most valuable. And of the units modeled, the combined heat and power is the most flexible. So for future work, to do a better understanding of profit, we have to take into account the battery installation costs and equipment costs. So this would better account for the cost of the energy capacity. Second, we could use a stochastic market clearing model instead of just assuming that the revenue is based on the average price as opposed to how it could actually happen in a real bidding scenario. And then lastly, it's possible to use geographically dispersed photovoltaic arrays to improve the overall availability and generation capacity of photovoltaics. That's all I have. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, questions, please?
Thank you for a very excellent presentation. You mentioned that the deep model uncertainties in the early stage in the model. Did you include any sensitivity analysis in the experimental in order to find out which of the variables are the most influential in such a way that uncertainty in those has influence on the output?
Yeah, I would say that the uncertainty in the control signal was the most important. So I kind of modeled it by using a different one, using a perfect forecast, so assuming we knew the signal perfectly, and then looking at different qualities of forecast, so a really good forecast versus a really bad one, and that had the most impact on the cost and the technical feasibility. So I did do some modeling of the unit availability forecast as well, so assuming that you did not know how much hydropower you had, and that had less effect because it was only one out of several units. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Any more questions?
You have introduced the model of predictivity analysis for the price, yes?
No.
What was a prediction model? Why not?
Not for the price, no.
Not for the price.
No.
Okay, this prediction model, what was the measure of accuracy? How you introduced it? And then exactly what was the volume of accuracy?
So the predictive part of it was using forecast of the control signal, and I used a mean squared error to determine the accuracy of that.
And numerical result?
Yeah.
Numerical result?
Yes.
What is the volume of this mean squared?
So for the primary signal, it's 0.0029. For the secondary signal, it's around the same. I don't remember the exact number. For the energy, it's I believe it's 0.05, so less good for the energy content.
It satisfies you.
Huh?
It satisfies you, yeah?
It was the best we could do, yes.
Thank you.
I don't understand why you make a prediction of what you call the primary signal. Because the primary control, the primary reserve, it's a security reserve and it's more to compensate, so it just enables the difference between demand and generation. So
you don't understand why I made a prediction?
Well, yeah.
Well, you have to forecast.
I'm not sure you can predict. For example, if you have a tripping of a power plant, in that case.
So it is hard to predict, but there have been some work done to show that there is some periodicity to the signal, especially in the, it has harmonics on the order of an hour, 30 minutes, 15 minutes, etc. And that just has to do with the change between, like we have day ahead markets that are hourly, and so you have a change in generation that doesn't always match the change in load. That's a hypothesis. But in order to do this model, you need some prediction. At least 2 hours is our horizon.
But you just can make a data analysis just to, yeah, maybe you can provide a forecast and what could be the variation of the frequency or what is the mean variation of the frequency and the standard deviation of the variation if you consider
so
a time range of 10 minutes, 1 hour, if you want.
If you do that, then you end up very conservative, and so you're not utilizing the battery optimally. You're always using less than you could, and it's more costly, and you may not be technically feasible in that sense. So we tried that initially, but it proved to be better to use this machine learning for at least a primary. So losing one unit in the plant?
Yeah.
No, I didn't do any N-1.
Any further questions? Well, thank you very much again.